Now, just talk for a second. Give me your name, rank, and serial number. I'll get a mic level.
My name is John McNally. I don't have any serial number. My name's John Edward McNally, and I live at 15 miles north of Kernville on the Johnsondale Road. It's called Fairview. I'm just about 1,700 feet below Fairview Lodge, and it's called McNally's Steakhouse. It's the oldest steakhouse in the country, and the best steakhouse in the country, I think. I was born in St. Louis, Missouri in 1913. Makes me 92, going on 93 in April. I left Missouri and went to Texas and was in Texas for quite a few years, which I enjoyed. Everything was wonderful in Texas. And a lot of fishing and crawdad fishing, and it was really good. Oh, I was just a kid. I lived on a small place, and we had cows and stuff. I got a sister that she was married to Bud Scovern. She passed away at Palm Desert. She was with me all the time in Texas and most all my life. My mom was the housekeeper, and my dad, he was traveling for George P.I.'s shirt company, and that's what he did for quite a few years. Yeah, he was gone a lot, so my mom and I was there to take care of everything. Bud Scovern was a good friend of mine, and his dad had the ranch Scovern Hot Springs. I decided to move up there, and when I moved up there to Scovern Hot Springs, then I went to farming. And I farmed on the Hot Springs Valley for many years, and then I farmed out in South Fork at the canebrake, put in 1,200 acres out there of wheat. We farmed wheat. And we raised cattle, and we was pretty busy farming and raising cattle. One time we had oats in the lower field and had over 2,000 bales of hay in that time. It was a really good crop. And we farmed the Hot Spring Valley for many years. It was pretty good, dry farming, but it was pretty good. Well, it would depend on the rains, and we'd get good rains some years, and some years we wouldn't, you know, and that was bad. But when I put in the canebrake out there that year, we got good rains and produced 14 sacks of wheat to the acre. That was really great. You know, we really did good on it that year. I was a rodeo producer and stock contractor, and put the rodeos on from almost all the 40s and 50s all over the country. First rodeo we ever put on was about 1931 or 32 in Scovern Hot Springs. We built the arena and had a rodeo there every year after that. And we had some of the best cowboys in the country come to that rodeo. Abe Lefton was the first announcer, and he was one of the greatest announcers in the rodeo business, and he was the first announcer we ever had to announce the rodeo. We got a lot of these horses from right here in the country, South Fork. They had horses that they couldn't ride. We'd bring them all here and try them out, and boy, they were pretty rank horses. They made the cowboys really hump to try to ride them. We took over the pack station here at the Fairview in 1940, and it was a lodge then. The main bar and everything was a lodge, and we served family-style meals. We had all our mules and all our horses, and we packed people in the mountains and fishing and hunting. And during the war, There was lots of people had to go come up here to go hunting because they couldn't go to Utah. They had to have gas and they couldn't get gas. So they all come up here and we were swamped during the war, packing people in the mountains. And we had quite a few. I had about four or five packers and it kept us all busy going into the mountains and out every day. Well, we went to Paloma and Trout Creek, Boone Pasture, and Bonita Meadow, and Mosquito Meadow, and we were all over the mountains as far as that goes in packing parties. And we'd take them hunting every day and pack their deer in for them, and then they fed, I had a cook, Betsy Berlando, cooked for me, and she was cooking in the cookhouse. And boy, we had quite a crew to feed, but she always managed to get it done. She was a wonderful cook. I drove a logging truck for Johnsondale for over 5 years. And it was pretty tough because when I was driving the truck, we had 12-foot bunks. And that's big loads when you put a 12-foot bunk and haul logs. And they didn't spare the horses when they put the loads on you. I hauled up to 110 ton a lot of times with that logging truck. And they didn't have the brakes that they have now on trucks. And we had to kind of baby them along. But we drove on the inside of the road so that the bank wouldn't cave off with us. And you had to be real careful because somebody come up there didn't know that you was on the inside of the road instead of the outside. And they didn't read the signs is what was the matter. And once in a while, somebody get run over, you know, up there. Yeah, I worked for Edison in the hydro. And that part is, we worked on the machines all the time. The hydro department did that and maintained everything on the outside, like the tunnels and the canals and all that. We worked on all that. And that was, I worked for them for about 5 years. Well, I've been working down at the aggregate plant and the boss had come up and asked me if I wanted to go to work on the dam. And I said, yeah, I'd like to. I've been working about 18 hours a day and I was getting pooped out. So he told me to come on up and go to work up there. And I went up and just started running a DW20. And almost all that cobblestone on the backside of that dam, I loaded in trucks. In 1956, I went to work for Tulare County Sheriff's Office, and I worked for them for 17 years, then retired. But that was a pretty good job. I had 750,000 acres in the Kern Plateau. I had 1,881 square miles by myself. And it was pretty I kept pretty busy. And the only ways I could get over the Kern Plateau, though, that 750,000 acres, was a horseback, airplane, or a foot. That's the only way we could get over it. And that's the way I got over all that Kern Plateau when anything had happened. Somebody's lost or something. The biggest thing, trouble was kids getting lost. And I had a little boy one time get lost up at Durwood, and he walked. He was lost for 31 hours before we found him, and he was barefooted, and all he had on was Levi's and a little leather jacket, and we found him. He was okay, and just give him a sandwich and got him out of there. I never drew my pistol one time in the 17 years, and I worked for the sheriff's office. I didn't have to. Only one time down here, I had a couple guys that had tire irons was coming at me. And I told him, you make one more step, and I'm going to kill you, both of you. So you either lay the irons down, and that's all, get in the back of the car. So they laid them down, and we got them in the back of the car, and I took them on to jail. Well, my whole family was raised here. All my children were raised here. I have three children. Mary Ann's the oldest, and then Butch, Joni's the second. And then Butch was the third. Yeah, Butch is John McNally Jr. They're all raised here, all went to school here, and they really love the valley. And Joni's over at Woody now, but Marianne's still right here. And the Butch is right down here at River Kern, so they're still in the valley. This country up here is one of the finest countries you could ever be in. It's, the weather is good, and the people are good, and you got everything in the world to enjoy here. You got fishing, hunting, and it's hiking. You can hike any place, and it's just a beautiful country. The Kern River Valley has been ever since I've been here, which is quite a few years, I'll tell you.